If Amazon came to me and said, please fix Maureen so that people like her in season three, I'd probably say, I can't. Nobody can.
Thank you, doctor. Take two of these and call me in the morning.
Hey, this is the Sword and the Pen Reflections. It is my casual alternative to that channel. So, okay, if Amazon came to me, would I actually say you can't fix her? Yeah, I would, because honestly, her character doesn't make any sense at this point. She's doing things that are completely illogical. Well, the whole show is being completely illogical. And as I've stated before in other videos, when you start out with a story that makes no sense getting from point A to point B, you just don't believe anything going forward. Even if it starts to improve, even if things start to make sense, you don't believe that they got to where they are. So it just doesn't matter. There's literally nothing you could do to fix the past. But let's say you've got a character that isn't particularly appealing. Maybe they've done some really bad things. Where would you even start with making them more likable? My theory is you need to give them the Greyjoy treatment.
Son of a bitch must pay.
And the Greyjoy treatment is not a redemption arc, but it is part of the redemption arc. Now, if you want a full breakdown of what the redemption arc is, I highly recommend you go and check out HelloFutureMe's video on redemption arcs up there and in the description. I could not do better than he did. But there is something that was just lightly touched on in his video, and I want to go further into it because I think this is something that people don't quite fully grasp when it comes to redeeming a character in a way that feels like, okay, the bad stuff that they've done in the past, he's kind of paid the price for it.
Justice.
Now, before I define what it is, I want to explain a little bit about how I came up with this term, the Greyjoy treatment. It's something I observed in Game of Thrones, the show, because I haven't read that far in the books. Theon Greyjoy is the bad guy's son who was captured and held hostage by the good guys, the Starks. But it's not your typical hostage situation. See, he was captured as a young child and then raised alongside the other Stark children as if he was one of them. He's treated very well, given all the same care, rights, and privileges as the other Stark children. But all of this good treatment is tainted by the constant knowledge that he isn't actually one of the Starks. He is, in fact, their prisoner. In the beginning, the audience's feelings towards Theon are kind of a mixed bag because he's got some really good qualities. He's loyal, courageous, has a very strong sense of duty, especially towards family. And because of his background, he carries a wisdom that the other Stark children don't have. But he's also got some very unlikable characteristics. He's definitely got a chip on his shoulder. He's arrogant, can sometimes be pompous, and towards women, he's borderline abusive, both physically and verbally. All of this is probably the result of being regularly reminded that he's not one of the Starks, and him telling himself that he's technically a prince of the Iron Islands. Now, when the Stark family finds themselves in need of military support, Theon travels back to the Iron Islands in an attempt to convince his family, the Greyjoys, to join the Starks. But the people of the Iron Islands do not respect Theon, and his father and sister Asha treat him more like a traitor who has joined the Starks, rather than the hostage who was surrendered to them against his will. They tell him that he has to make a choice between them and the Starks. Desperate to prove himself to the Greyjoys, his true family, Theon reluctantly betrays the Starks. And when simply abandoning helping the Starks seems not to be enough to win the favor of his father and sister, he allows himself to be convinced to do something treacherous. He returns to the Stark home, Winterfell, while it is most vulnerable, headed by the second youngest son, Bran, who's just a child, and he takes possession of it. It's obvious that Theon is struggling to be okay with doing the things he is doing, but he presses on in a kind of manic determination to follow through. In his eyes, if he doesn't do these things, he will fail the Greyjoys. He appears to know that he's gone too far against the Starks to go back, and so he has no choice but to double down. He commits some very unlikable, truly unforgivable crimes in the capture of Winterfell. He beheads the master at arms, the very man who taught him how to use a sword. He has two orphans murdered in order to display their charred bodies and claim that he has killed the two youngest Stark children. And as a result of that order, a farmer and his wife are also killed. Theon could not be less likable than he is at this point. But when Winterfell is surrounded by one of the Stark allies, the Boltons, who have come to liberate the castle, Theon's own men, who don't respect him anyway, betray him and leave him for his enemies. Theon wakes up in a dark dungeon, strapped to a cross, and for the length of an entire season, he is tortured brutally. There seems to be no real reason for it. He's interrogated for useless information, and even when he answers all the questions to the apparent satisfaction of his tormentors, the torture continues. One night, Theon is rescued by a man claiming to have been sent by his sister Asha. He's led out of the dungeon, gets a good distance away, gets captured again the next day, but is saved again. During this rescue, Theon confesses remorse for the crimes he has committed and regret for what he has done. He seems to be truly penitent. Then it is revealed that his rescuer has not, in fact, led him to freedom, rather right back to the same dungeon he has been imprisoned in all this time. It was all just a trick for the sadistic pleasure of his captor and pretend rescuer, Ramsay Bolton. And the torture continues. During one of the torture sessions, Ramsay flays one of Theon's fingers until Theon begs for it to be cut off. In another, Theon is seduced by two women, then castrated. He is tortured until he begs for death three times, but he is never given that mercy. He is broken physically, emotionally, and mentally. Ramsay even tortures him to the point that he believes Theon Greyjoy is no more, and his new name is Reek. After the Greyjoys are sent Theon's amputated genitals, his biological sister, Asha, comes to rescue him. At that point, though, Theon is fully brainwashed. He's so convinced that it's another trick, he fights her, refusing to go with her, and Asha is forced to leave him behind to save herself and the lives of her men. Completely under the control of his captor, Theon spends the entire next season as a devoted servant to Ramsay, enduring his endless psychological and emotional torment, obsessing over pleasing him, terrified of causing the slightest displeasure, being forced to watch and do horrible things. Theon's adoptive sister, Sansa Stark, is eventually engaged to Ramsay. Theon is too afraid to do anything to help her, as he is explicitly forced to witness her abuse. When Sansa begs Theon to help her escape, he instead betrays her to Ramsay, so convinced that it is not only impossible to escape, but that it would have been worse for her in the end if she had even tried. But when Sansa's life is threatened by one of Ramsay's underlings, he cannot just stand by and watch. He saves her life, helps her escape, and sends her off to the protection of her brother, Jon. In that sending, he expresses that he deserved everything that he got, that he deserved to be Reek. He goes back to the Iron Islands, only to find that his father is dead and the kingdom has been all but stolen from his sister Asha. He pledges himself to her and goes with her into battle. But when she is captured, Theon is overcome with a sudden fear of being tortured again. Instead of trying to save her, he runs away. But this time, the regret is immediate. As soon as he has the means and opportunity, he takes command of her old crew. They are resistant at first, but Theon stands his ground, and he and the crew are able to rescue Asha. In the finale, Theon joins the only remaining Stark siblings in the final battle to defend Winterfell against the White Walkers, the great zombie army led by the Night King. He requests and is given a position standing guard over the very person from whom he stole Winterfell years before, Bran. When at last it seems that the battle has been lost and the end has come, rather than abandoning Bran and fleeing for his life, Theon charges the Night King, knowing he will not survive, but restoring his courage, loyalty, and honor. By the end of this story, I no longer had a dislike of Theon as a character. Redemption is a ransoming of the soul, and that's what he did. He ransomed his own soul by paying in full for his crimes and changing his ways. If, when the Boltons arrived at Winterfell, Theon had simply fled and continued on in the rest of the story to be a good man of courage and honor, I don't think the audience would have felt the satisfaction that we did get. We would have felt that there was a debt left yet unpaid. But Theon did pay, in full, and with the right currency. This, I think, is truly essential for even just the opportunity of redemption to feel paid for. Then it's good deeds that go on to earn likability. And so this is how I came up with the Greyjoy treatment, breaking down exactly what has to be done to fully expunge the record of characters who have done bad things, but that the audience or readers are supposed to like by the end. Was he a likable character by the end? At the very least, we can say he was neutral. He was no longer unlikable. Like, he made up for what happened in the past. But let me get into this. Please like, subscribe, and comment, even if it's just with an emoji. It's a free way to support this channel. Or if you're feeling generous, you can check out my Patreon, Ko-fi, or hit the Money Heart Thanks button. You can become a patron or leave a one-time tip. Now, let's get back to it. So, a definition of the Greyjoy treatment, as I have written here. The Greyjoy treatment is when a character receives fitting punishment equal to or greater than the sins they have committed. It permanently alters their view of the world and how they function in it, and the characters recognize that this punishment was deserved. Karma, essentially. So how would you know that Theon Greyjoy has received the Greyjoy treatment in its completion, so that way an audience feels like he's paid the price for his wrongdoing? Well, first what you need to do is tally up all the things that he's done that are unlikable in the eyes of the audience. First, there are his major crimes. 5 murders, which would be the master at arms, the 2 orphans, and the 2 farmers. 3 abandonments, which includes not returning to aid Robb Stark in the war, not intervening in Sansa's abuse by Ramsay, and also running away when Asha, or actually her name is Yara in the show, was captured. Asha's her name in the book. And 3 betrayals, which includes Robb Stark, Bran Stark, and Sansa Stark. That pretty much comes under the umbrella of one big betrayal of the Stark family as a whole. Theon's unlikable traits are more complicated because they're all co-related and overlap each other in several areas of his personality. Just a reminder, though, he is arrogant, prideful, pompous, has a spiteful streak to accompany the chip on his shoulder, and he's abusive both physically and verbally, especially in intimate interactions.
That's a lot.
Without going into all the concrete examples, which would result in a 2-hour video, I'll list some specifics. We see elements of these unlikable traits manifest in his sense of hierarchy of authority and his place within it. He is disrespectful towards not only people who are lower than him in the chain of command, but also towards those who simply have no authority over him. His unlikable traits are also evident in his over-regard for his heritage and birthright. He gloats about the greatness of the Ironborn and their less-than-great deeds, and he expects to be treated and thought of as a royal prince by the people who are technically his subjects, but who he has never met or helped in any way before. I guess except for being held hostage by the Starks. Anyway, we especially see these unlikable traits in his sexual interactions. He is overtly domineering, being physically rough with women despite knowing he is hurting them, putting them down to their faces, and he behaves as though he is not only entitled to any woman he wants, but that these women should be honored to be chosen and then discarded by him. It is repeated throughout the show that he is well endowed, and he certainly seems to know it. Now what we need to do is look at his period of punishment and see if he has paid for each one of these things. And the punishment needs to fit the crime, and it must be equal to or greater than the crime that was committed.
Buckle up.
Again, to save time, I'm not going to go over everything in full detail. I'll just cover the main points, but I will give a few examples of how some of these calculations are a little more complicated. Then I invite you to think about how some of my conclusions were reached. Okay, so the simplest crimes to pair with their respective punishments are the major ones. First, there are the 5 murders. Theon is responsible for taking 5 lives, and so he should be murdered 5 times. Well, he was murdered at the end of the series when he chose to save Bran. That's one murder taken care of. But he's only got 1 life, right? Wrong. I truly believe that this is one issue where there is some flexibility. A permanent personality assassination could arguably count as a murder, and so could anything suffered where death would have been the preference. So under that definition, what else is there in Theon's story? Well, we have his brainwashing until he believes Theon is no more, and he really isn't the same man ever again after this. If you compared the before and after, apart from the face, he is unrecognizable. That's one murder. Then we get Theon begging for death 3 times when he's being tortured. Now, if he begged for death on 3 separate occasions, we could count that as three separate life debts paid. Unfortunately, he begs for death three times during only one torture session, so we're just counting that as a very strong third murder. And this works to top off the weaker fourth and fifth murders. The fourth is Theon living to become things that his season one self would have rather chosen death over. He becomes a coward, a traitor to his family, and the lowest, most degraded form of human. In the scene where he pledges himself to fight for Robb Stark until death, he declared that death would be his preference to being what we see him eventually become. So that's the fourth. Now the fifth is the biggest stretch. It's the moment when Theon begs Ramsay to cut off his finger instead of continuing to flay it. This is a derivative of a much bigger reality. He would prefer the permanent removal of his finger over the continued pain being experienced by it. By this logic, if it was his legs or his torso that was being flayed, he would have just as easily begged for them to be cut off, even though it would have been fatal. Moving on to his abandonments and betrayals, the distinction being that an abandonment is an individual's choice to not save someone they could have, and betrayal is going against someone's trust and causing them harm. Some of these overlap in Theon's committed crimes, such as his abandonments and betrayals of Robb and Sansa, and I find that some of his punishments overlap as well. We have his father learning of Theon's capture and torture, yet choosing not to try to save him. Then we have Asha, or Yara, going to try to save him, but him refusing to leave, and then she is forced to abandon him instead of making another attempt. Then it could also be argued that Theon abandons himself. He completely gives up on any attempt to save himself even when he is allowed to leave the castle. And along this same train of thought, Theon is also betrayed when Reek fights his biological sister to stay with Ramsay. We also have when Theon was betrayed by his men who leave him for the Boltons. And then there's when pretend rescuer Ramsay gained Theon's trust and friendship and then betrayed him to, well, to himself. We might even add the betrayal of the two women who seduced Theon and then handed him over to Ramsay to be castrated. But I don't think they were ever really consciously trusted by Theon. But that's it. Technically, three betrayals and three abandonments. For Theon's unlikable personality traits, all that is needed to punish him are moments when those parts of his personality take a hit that permanently derails them. The pride and arrogance he has in relation to his family and his birthright is crushed when he actually meets the Greyjoys and finds that they really aren't great or honorable, and his birthright is denied him. His heirs of authority are likewise smashed into pieces when the ironborn men given to him to command not only don't listen to him, but even manipulate him to make him do what they want. But all shortcomings in the punishment he receives for his crimes and his unlikable personality are ultimately made up for in his overpayment for his abusive traits. Yes, Theon was verbally and mildly physically abusive, especially in his sexual relationships, but at no point did Theon ever actually force himself on someone that couldn't deter him with mere words. Neither did he mutilate or cause such physical damage as to leave bruises or scars. And the verbal abuse was never more than a sting to the ego. Yet, nearly every fitting punishment for these unlikable traits suffered by Theon in this respect is taken far beyond what he ever did to anyone else. He is verbally abused to the point that his entire identity is extinguished. He is burned, bruised, cut, and as far as sexual abuse is concerned, nothing he did to others compares to being pinned to the ground, partially stripped, and nearly raped. And being castrated, not only emasculating him, but taking away his ability to carry on the family bloodline, be of desirable match to anyone, or even experience sexual pleasure ever again, is a degree of punishment that so far exceeds his unlikable personality traits that the extra change can surely cover any deficit in the rest of his karma. I know I skipped over a lot, but trust me, if you look through Theon's life, every unlikable thing that he did does have either an immediate consequence that kind of undoes what he did, such as when he groped the girl who escorted him to the castle on the Iron Islands, only to realize that that was his sister and everything he was saying just made him look more the fool. Or he got some other fitting punishment further down the line. So, looking back on the definition of the Greyjoy treatment, we see that Theon received punishment equal to or greater than the crimes he committed. These punishments fit their respective crimes. Theon recognized that he deserved these punishments, and he was permanently altered in his view of the world and how he functioned in it. For the better, I should add. I think I'm getting the gist of it across, and that is essentially that you want to go through every suffering that he experienced and see if it covers one of his unlikable traits or one of his crimes in the past. Because if he has paid for that crime, we no longer feel like he needs to have his ass kicked. Now, with Moraine, there are a lot of times we feel like she needs to have her ass kicked. And the reason is because she's doing these horrible things, treating people terribly, but then she's not paying any prices for it. I think that the writers might have thought that, okay, having her power sealed from her, that is enough punishment for her. But the thing is I don't feel like it is. I think that what it does is it makes her feel powerless, but it doesn't stop her from behaving in a bad way towards everybody. So we would need to see her stopping that behavior and recognizing that this is how I was treating other people when I was in a position of great power over them. Now, Theon, in his story, did have a moment where he stopped and he said, I can't believe I betrayed the family that raised me.
I murdered those boys so I could keep Winterfell and make my father proud. My real father lost his head at King's Landing. I made a choice, and I chose wrong.
I'll tell him the truth about Brennan Rickon.
The truth about Sir Roderick, who I beheaded. And the truth about Rob, who I betrayed.
We'll get justice for you.
If I got justice, my burnt body would hang over the gates of Winterfell.
Then we'll get revenge.
I deserved everything. I deserve to be wreaked.
We need Moraine to have a moment like that. If she doesn't, then she just sees it as bad luck and like, oh, poor me, like I'm such a victim. You can't have that. You need to have her look at herself and say, I deserve this. Now, the only time that we see her express any remorse that I can recall from season two is in the finale, which spoilers for people who haven't seen the finale, when she talks to Lan and tells him that, you know, when I said that I never thought of us as equals, I always thought that you were my better. It's very, very hard to believe that that is the case. I'm still left with a bad feeling towards Moraine because she hasn't paid the price for how she made Lan feel. He was unconditionally devoted to her and would do anything for her, and yet she treated him like crap and with glee treated him like crap. We need to see that somebody who she is devoted to treats her this way, and she recognizes this is what I did to Lan. Now, the only time that I can see this having an opportunity for this would be with Suan. So my advice to Amazon would be in season three, you need to have Suan completely betray Moraine and treat her horrifically. It can't just be, oh, you're the bad guy now. It has to be like, I've never loved you. I've never cared about you. You've always been lesser than me. And it needs to hurt her in the same way that she hurt Lan. Unfortunately, she has her power back now. So I'm not seeing an opportunity where we can put her in the position where she has put other people in the past, where we saw that she was, you know, Bale Doman. She was treating him horribly and tricking him to come and bring her a piece of, it was the poem and Quendiar. And then cheating him out of money and ruining his life and just giving him some cash. Like, here, go run away and, you know, good luck to you. And the same thing with her sister. You know, I thought, okay, maybe they're going to do this with the sister because the sister is the one who gets the upper hand on her when she goes out and turns Moraine's network into her network. Like, everybody who was yours is now mine. And if you want to know where that boy with the red hair is, you're going to have to ask me very nicely over tea. I don't necessarily feel that Moraine felt like she deserved that from her sister. The reason being is that in the next episode, we see Moraine be horrible. Is it the next episode or two episodes later? It doesn't matter. It's a couple episodes later. She is horrible to her sister, essentially saying, like, this house is mine and I can turn you out of it if I want. Like, I still have the upper hand. So she didn't really see that she had been doing this to her sister in the past. And then her sister turns it around on her and she goes, oh, this is what it's like. I'll never do this again to someone I love. She just goes right back and does it. So that is an opportunity that has come and gone. Unless we can see that somehow Moraine's sister still has a huge amount of influence that is more powerful than Moraine's, and then she can see the light and go like, oh, you're right, I should never treat you this way, you didn't deserve this. But so that is my explanation for what the Greyjoy treatment is, which is a term I coined, spread it around. If you have a character who is unlikable, who has done bad things, and your audience just doesn't connect with them. You can't just have them start changing their ways and doing good things. They have to pay the price for the wrong that they have done. And that is what the Greyjoy treatment is. So again, what is the criteria for the Greyjoy treatment? They have to receive punishment that is equal to or greater than what they have done in the past. Their punishment must fit their crimes. They must recognize that this is a punishment for what I have done in the past to others. And finally, it permanently alters their view of the world and how they function in it. At the end, make sure that you've tallied up everything that they have done wrong and give them sufficient punishment for each one of those crimes. From there, I think you can start to build a likable character, not just one that's gotten their due karma. So, can Moraine be saved? Can Galadriel be saved? I don't know. I'd be surprised if they can. Honestly, I really don't think that you can with Moraine. Galadriel, maybe. But she has a lot of suffering that she needs to go through, and she needs to recognize that she deserves it. I just don't see them doing that with Galadriel. I guess that's it. This is the Sword and the Pen Reflections coming to you from Kenai Lake, just north of Seward, Alaska. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and comment, even if it's just with an emoji. Or if you're feeling really generous, check out my Patreon, Ko-fi, or hit the Money Heart Thanks button down below. Be good to yourself.